This is Jean Friedman, Content Manager for RSA Conference, and welcome to the webcast, Metrics or Bunk, the Zombie Apocalypse Baseball and Security Metrics. I am pleased to introduce Josh Corman and Alex Hutton, who have an updated version of their highly rated session from RSA Conference 2011 and RSA Conference Europe this year. Joshua Corman is the Director of Security Intelligence for Akamai Technologies and has more than a decade of experience with security and networking software. Most recently, he served as Research Director for Enterprise Security at the 451 Group, following his time as Principal Security Strategist for IBM Internet Security Systems. Alex Hutton is Director of Operational Risk at a financial institution, and over the past 15 years, he served a number of different roles for various security companies. Previously, he served as Principal in Research and Risk Intelligence with Verizon Business. Both Josh and Alex are prolific bloggers and are actively committed to taking the information security industry to the next level. I will now turn it over to Josh and Alex for their presentation.
Thank you, Jean. So we invaded this last spring's security conference with actual live zombies, if that's not an oxymoron. So you won't have that effect on the web, but we'll try to keep it lively and entertaining. What we're going to cover together is what we have versus what we want. I'm going to use a colorful zombie apocalypse as a metaphor. We kind of did this before it was cool and had The Walking Dead and the CDC copying us. But then Alex is going to transition into Moneyball and baseball and how statistics have helped in a field that's more akin to the dynamic nature of IT security.
And we were cool there also before it was trendy. We're that hipster. I just want to put that out.
There was no movie for Moneyball then. So now that people have copied us, it's no longer cool, and we're going to have to ditch this talk.
Oh, yeah, totally.
Excellent. All right. Gene gave us some intros, so we really don't need to. But I finally did start blogging at Cognitive Dissonance, and some of this material is there. And Alex?
If I had to say anything about it, what you're looking at here, Society of Information Risk Analysts, yay! We do a lot of work. It's right now at the mailing list. We're going to have a actual chapter in meetings and so forth. It's a great place to go if you're interested in this topic, you're interested in risk, and you want to hear what some really smart people, meaning other people other than myself, but if you want to hear what really smart people are actually doing in a pragmatic, practical, everyday, this is their job sense, it's a great mailing list to be on. So check that out.
Yeah, and besides a shared passion for numbers and pragmatism, Alex and I are also kind of have a passion for being advocates for CISOs and other security practitioners instead of perpetuating FUD or whatnot. Most of our opinions come from working and thinking and pushing on behalf of the people who have to deal with all these changes in our environment. So a couple opening remarks from the two of us. How did this fight start, besides the fact that zombies do not love you? They are not your friends. So I basically looked at all the risk metrics lists and everything we were tracking, and even though I desperately wanted to see some, I basically said metrics are total bunk. You guys are trying to measure the available data. You're measuring what's easy, not what's important, and while you're busy measuring it, we're getting our intellectual property stolen left and right, and we need to institute more of a survival instinct.
And my response to that, of course, was, you academic prig, what industrial solvents are you smoking, right? Metrics are actually what helps us realize that we're actually being owned. Metrics are the things that help us understand how bad it is when we're being owned and so forth. So that's kind of where it started.
Now, at the time when I was the research director for the 451 group and putting my analyst hat on, I tried to take a macro-level picture of the industry. And essentially, from the CISOs I worked with, I saw five sources of constant and turbulent change, which kind of ballooned the cost complexity of security to unacceptable levels. When you combine that with a down economy late 2008, in our duress and confusion, we turned to checklists, we turned to mandatory spending versus discretionary or risk-driven spending. And as a consequence, we'll get to this diagram later, but we kind of broke the market in half between a risk management minority, no middle market, and a checkbox laggard majority. And we will touch on that later. A couple points about metrics and lampposts that Alex and I have shared. One is, we lack data where we are today. We have faith-based security, or as Wendy Nather from 451 likes to call it, commandment-based when thinking of compliance mandates. What do we want?
Well, we want evidence-based decision support, right? We want metrics. We want to use actuarial methods in order to understand what we're doing and what we should be doing in the future.
You know, and part of my pushback here is what we have is essentially numerology. It's still faith-based. It's just faith in the available numbers. And we can do better than this, so we should. You know, there's the thing about lies, damn lies, and statistics. I also particularly like the Scholz-Netzing quote. Another thing we have is this is one of my favorite quotes of all time, but he used statistics like a drunk uses lampposts, more for support than illumination. Does that resemble how vendors tend to use these reports?
No comment.
This one was really a hot button with when I was talking to Dan Gere a lot. I said, we're kind of looking where the light is best. If you trace most of our available statistics, it's where it's the data types that are backed by mandatory disclosure laws, like California Senate bill. So it's really PII or regulated stuff like card data, whereas I felt the more serious breaches, we had a whole lot less consistent and less available information. So it's good to use the data we have, but we might have lost our keys or more important things elsewhere. You know, and there's bias and there's selection bias and all sorts of different things. And I'm sure we each have our selection bias, right, Alex? But hopefully they don't have us.
Sure.
Honest.
Yeah, and that's there's a subtitle to this, which is intellectual honesty, which I think is the important piece, right? It's great to use the data breach investigations report, excellent document. It's great to use the trust wave reports, all that stuff. But you have to be intellectually honest with how and why you use them. You know, it always hurt when I was with Verizon to watch other vendors use this stuff and totally blow the meaning out of the water. You know, but we were always bigger than that and never pointed out, you know, that's not really what it says here. And now it's kind of fun because I get to do that. I'm not bound by Verizon's ethics. But I think that's the key, right, is always questioning how intellectually honest is this Poneman Institute study? How intellectually honest is the DBIR, right? And what biases are inherent within?
Excellent, yep. And we probably should do a talk where we show the worst offenses of that. this smart guy said some things about statistics as well, which I completely agree with. You know, but Alex, you know, how many times have you heard this?
Right, yeah, I want actuarial tables.
And typically my rebuttal is, you know, and I want a pony. if you're geeky enough, then it's something like this. But, you know, the instinct for actuarial certainty is you know, valid. It just may not be realistic. So are we using the wrong models? We often use the automotive industry and you know, car accidents and whatnot, and we have actuarial tables and they go into policy premiums and things. You know, but the laws of physics are pretty static. They don't really change very often, whereas with sentient adversaries and different adoption patterns and complex systems on top of complex systems, we have uncontrolled and uncontrollable variables, so our expectations may not be appropriate. I showed this quickly before, and I'm going to breeze through it in the interest of getting some questions at the end, but you know, this was something I drew after talking to a bunch of CISOs through IANS, or the Applied Institute for Applied Network Security. And there's changes on all fronts, and I basically would say, look, if you do some vector analysis, you know, are things getting better, worse, or the same on each of these five sources that contribute to our overall costs, complexity, and risk? And essentially, you know, when we just ask people instinctually, well, the threats are getting much worse, much faster in 2011. We have a breach a week. We have things like, you know, Anonymous, and we have things like state-sponsored espionage, stealing intellectual property, and so it definitely feels worse. There's more types of adversaries. Compliance is predictable in its frequency of release, but it's still tightening the noose. There's more of them, and they're getting more teeth. Technology adoption is much faster than it used to be, like lots of static periods, and now we have x86 virtualization, cloud computing, et cetera. Economics budgets are flat to down, so that got a little worse, and businesses are increasing their appetites for change. So without, you know, doing a scary kitten-killing APT talk, you know, we do have new adversaries, and they're more persistent and tenacious, and they're after higher-value targets than maybe we did a few years ago when it was more joyriding or petty theft, like you know, easy automated attacks against credit card data. In fact, you know, several of the relationships I have in Fortune 100 companies lost intellectual property last year. Not all of them are public about it, going back to where the light is best, but it's gotten substantially worse for people who used to feel that their security programs were enough and felt in 2011 the chickens came home to roost. So instead of fearing these new attackers and adversary classes like state-sponsored espionage or, you know, chaotic actors like Anonymous and LulzSec, we fear a different kind of attacker. We fear the auditor more. One of the CISOs at a DOD event said, you know, my top threat actor is the auditor. So in his models, he considered them a threat actor, and I thought that was actually pretty useful. He said, I might get hacked, but I will be fined. So many of us have really optimized for a checklist, and we're going to show the folly of that later when we talk about adversary classes and strengths. You know, and one of the problems is we have disparate rates of change in the industry. So this will look familiar when we get to H.D. Moore's Law, but essentially what you have is a growing threat and a plateaued or stagnant counter-threat. So I'll just keep it that simple and high-level for the moment. Because we can't infinitely spend, and it would be infeasible and uneconomic to do so. One of the things I noticed when I actually had all the access to all the market shares and data as an analyst was I counted about 70 different product categories. Gartner has over 100 and something. But only 11 of them got any spending between 2009 and 2011. And they were basically PCI's chosen few or other things that matched the mandatory list of some sort of compliance regime. It didn't matter that these were some of our oldest and least effective controls, and by no means do I think we should be needing 70-plus categories. Something more realistic would be that third column. But we ended up doing what we were told to do instead of what maybe we needed to do. Next, we also assume, we forget, and this is an opportunity for a new metric, but we kind of forget the efficacy of our controls decay over time. So there was a time when IPS was 100% detection as long as you kept your signatures current. Same thing with signature AB. But now, like, if you look at the NSS test labs over the last few years, even the market leaders are somewhere around 14 to 18 to 19% detection. So if we believe and perceive that those once best practices still work as well as they used to, it's simply not true. So our confidence in our countermeasures needs to factor how effective these things are over time. A similar example I use is how are we handling this rate of decay? You know, if you think of produce or if anyone's ever smelled or unfortunately drank sour milk, you'll never forget it. So do we get rid of our oldest spoiled past due date security technologies? Is it first in, first out? I've actually encountered that we've never retired a single control. So when we run out of budget and money, we stop innovating. We stop keeping pace with possibly more effective people, process, and technology. So it's quite a shame, and we would never treat this with our produce the way we do with our billions in information security spending. So the zombie apocalypse, I'll try to speed through some of this so we can get to some of the more interesting content later. It's been a fun year using zombies as a metaphor. But some of you know I did the PCI, the No Child Left Behind Act for IT security. And really what I was trying to point out is in that first column, you had people doing excellent risk management. These were typically the Wall Street elite or pharmaceuticals. A couple of years later, the mainstream would adopt those practices, and that was the bulk of the market. And then the laggards would trail behind a few more years because it just wasn't that core to them, or they didn't feel they were attacked as often. One of the things I tried to assert is by trying to raise the bar for the negligent, that fourth column doing nothing to secure card data, for example, paired with the down economy, we basically evaporated that mainstream middle average buyer. So we tried to make the dumb kids smarter, so to speak, and we made the average kids dumber. So what we have is essentially a bifurcated market of a risk management minority who want good and modern defenses, and then most people are just doing what used to be best practices quite some time ago. And perhaps we think that's good enough, so we tell our little kids the three little pigs of the straw house, stick house, and brick house, good, better, best. But sometimes good enough isn't, right? So you know, the straw house wasn't enough to stop the big bad wolf. And depending on which metrics and how you interpret them, it isn't proving enough to secure the interests of most of these companies. So would a stick house be better? Is a brick house required, et cetera? Now, in a zombie apocalypse, and thank goodness for The Walking Dead being such an excellent show and shining more light on how extreme circumstances can change the way we look at things and how we prioritize, we do find ourselves amidst extreme circumstances. And it's not really about the dead, it's about how do the living adapt to these new circumstances, environments. So if the zombies were chasing you and your family through a field, would you choose that straw house? Probably not. The dilapidated wooden barn? Yeah, if it was better than nothing. But if you had the choice, you'd go for the defensible brick structure. So there's also a rates of change thing, which is really where the zombie debate came up, actually at a baseball game, funny enough. But what I said is if you look at the time it takes to collect a sufficient corpus of data, analyze that data, derive actionable evidence, communicate that advice, and then enact that advice, let's call that X. And then if you look at the half-life, let's bring in the Albert Einstein half-life graphic. If you look at the half-life of that advice, because it does have an expiration date as well, then the relationship between X and lambda tell you if you should even bother with that metrics pursuit. The rate of change may be so rapid and so chaotic, like a baseball park overrun by the living dead, that you might just need to think on your feet instead of waiting for actuarial certainty. So let's use a concrete example instead of all this rhetoric, right? So I took the Verizon DBIR, which is one of our best sources with the most rigor and transparency of method, and I looked at patching. And part of this was the vendor's fault, but essentially in 2008, everyone heard that 90% of these breaches were patchable and the patch was available for 12 to 18 months. But if you actually read the report versus some PowerPoint slide of vendors stuck in front of you, it was 22% of them were patchable, and of those, 90% had a patch available for more than a year. So the high-line advice was, let's patch faster. Perhaps you remember hearing that or reading that. And in point of fact, when Alex and I surveyed all our CISO friends, the top most frequent metric we heard was we're going to reduce the mean time from patch available to patch deployed from X weeks to Y weeks. The following year, though, let's look at these rates of change. Only 6 of 90 of the breaches in that report were patchable. That's less than 10%. And then the following year, none of them were patchable vulnerabilities. They were usually at the application layer or custom malware or some other injection vector in the A4 model. So the net result of us spending most of our time maybe over-rotating on patching faster was we were zombie food. Not that kind of zombie food, and since some of our friends on the line are vegans, they eat grains. And my wife is a dietitian, so she bought me this zombie food guide pyramid for Christmas last year. And you'll notice lots and lots of brains, a little bit of bones or gristle, but no credit cards. And that actually got me thinking for my Pachachka talk on that zombies love PCI because we're so distracted protecting card data, we've left what's in our brains, which is what they really want, the intellectual property and trade secrets and corporate secrets, vulnerable and prone. So in response, I made my own little zombie survival pyramid for information security. And the first thing I thought about is let's just use the metaphor. If we're being chased through the field by the undead and we have to survive the night, we might stand a chance in that brick building, but we probably won't stand a chance in that indefensible barn. So the defensibility of infrastructure is a much larger topic, touched on with our rugged software initiative, but that is a huge determinant, possibly the largest determinant, in if you are going to be able to secure your information and your interests. And we often skip this step. The second most important step in surviving is kind of Gene Kim 101. If you haven't read Visible Ops or looked at the metrics outlined within, this is basically saying if step one was reducing your attack surface, this one's about reducing your operational entropy and chaos. This is the thing that points out, you know, we want to know what we have, know when it changes, zero unplanned changes, and highlighted that CISOs that used to be in the Marine Corps are much more effective than most. So what are the key success factors? And it's really about having your wits about you and keeping your survivors calm and disciplined, and you might actually survive the night. Third, in order of importance and sequence, is situational awareness. This is kind of like the ooh in the OODA loop of observe, orient, decide, act. Richard Batelick's kind of one of the voices for the idea of incident response, of see more, sooner, prompt, and agile response. In our zombie apocalypse scenario, this might be having more light to see which directions the zombies are attacking or sensors. So we're not fighting in the dark, fighting blindly and dying quickly. This allows us to know who's attacking from which direction and how many of them are there to better inform our economic use of where we tend to spend our time, which is specific countermeasures. So rather than clicking on 11 of the PCI chosen few and hoping that those are the right things to defend us in indefensible architectures without discipline of our organizational operations and without having the visibility to see how we're actually attacked, what's proven to be much more effective against state-sponsored espionage or IP-stealing criminal gangs or even some of these chaotic actors who want to shame you is having that generic and pervasive visibility to inform which countermeasures are most appropriate for who is attacking which data. But we will move on. I wish it was so simple as just having zombies, but, you know, maybe instead of using your silver bullets on a zombie, you want to save them for the werewolves and the other different kinds. So, baseball. Alex, take it away.
All right. So, let's talk about baseball for a second. One of my past lives, I actually got to record stats at a AAA level that were then, you know, sold off to the big leagues. It was very interesting to watch what they did versus watch everybody else. You know, everybody else at the time knew batting average, and they knew home runs and knew RBIs. But what we were doing was completely different, and it was for a completely different decision-making, right? And so it was fascinating to me. I really got into all of this. So what does this have to do? Well, in baseball, you have a bounded complexity, we'll call it, right? And we do have boundaries in InfoSec. It's not always, you know, the attacker or the adversary is intelligent, so therefore we can't know what to do or how to do it or anything, and you throw up your hands and you run around screaming. No, the reality of it is we have some boundaries, and we need to understand what those are. So really, the problem is that we're not answering the big question with our metrics. Right, and that's so what, okay? So what about patching faster? So what about antivirus rates? Right? And so what I'd like to do is I really wanted to help us answer that so what question, right? And the good news is it's relatively simple conceptually. We need to understand what creates successes and what causes failures, right? And it's important to know that if we can understand what creates success and what causes failure, we can do a better job. And that's why we have to have these relatively academic discussions about security and risk and why we need to measure it, right? I of all people, understand that they can be tedious. You know, but ultimately, we need to make decisions. And these decisions have to be about risk management as defined. And this is Jack Jones's definition. This is not something you'll find in an ISACA document or an ISO document. But I like this best because it captures the essence of what we need to do here in managing risk. It's not just a plan, do, check, act cycle that you institute as a management process and you call that, yeah, that's my risk management function. No. You have to understand that we're aligning our capabilities to manage risk, the exposures that we have to the tolerance of the data owners. Okay, and that's really, really important because once you understand that capabilities matter, and certainly that's the lesson we get from Visible Ops, both in IT and for Visible Ops for security, it's what we get when we look at the data breach investigation report, then we can start talking about exposure. You know, then we can start talking about the zombie hordes that may or may not be coming at us and management's tolerance, which is basically our budget, right? There is a great problem here, and that risk and security right now are hypothetical constructs. There isn't a formalism behind how many security per units, you know, do you have. There isn't a metric there, right? Risk is a little better, but not quite yet, okay? So what I thought I'd do is I thought I'd run us with, you know, if we have such a hypothetical construct, how do we humans kind of get observable factors? How do we tend to do formalist approaches? And I thought what I'd do is use kind of a FAST as an example, right? Now, remember that we haven't always had measurement that would help us understand FAST that has been as wonderful as we have now. And at first, right, there was only one real measurement, which was did we survive? Could we outrun the predator? Then we were able to say, okay, well, now I can do some comparison, right? This Greek in the Olympic Games was faster than that Greek, right? And we can even do over time, right? If it's a marathon, well, he's a half a day faster or what have you. Then with sundials, you could actually start to put units of measurement together along with distances. But when we got better precision in units, now we can do wonderful things like slow down light and watch it, right? If you've seen that recently. So if that's kind of a brief overview of how we as have traditionally taken these hypothetical constructs, added formalist positions, and then kind of walked through and gotten to a point where we can have a harder science than we currently have, I think the question in front of us is where do we sit? And there's a lot of people who talk about pseudoscience and so forth. I like to think of us as a proto-science, if you're familiar with the work of philosopher Thomas Kuhn. But the answer, either way, whether you're a glass half empty or half full kind of guy, is it's not good, right? We're kind of nuts, and we're seen that way by everybody, right? It's very unfortunate. And, you know, CVSS, fantastic people, great work, something we all use, but it's full of this sort of craziness, right? And it may be right, but we wouldn't know. Take, for example, this. The base equation multiplies impact by 0.6 and exploitability by 0.4. And there's a couple things that we need to know when we start saying that we have, in fact, multiplied impact by 0.6 and exploitability by 0.4. The first is kind of, this doesn't make any sense. If you look at what you're doing, you're kind of, using ordinal scales, and don't let the decimal fool you. Decimals aren't magical unicorn feces. They don't suddenly create ratio values. You're basically doing jet engine times peanut butter equals shiny, in terms of coming up with math, right? And that's the state of the art that we deal in today, right? And to be fair, right, speed is simple, relatively simple now. Security and risk are much more complex than having a simple kind of two-vector equation coming to us. And we do have a chicken and egg problem around models and measurements that we're dealing because we're a proto-science, right? You kind of need good models to tell you where to look to get measurements. But on the other hand, in order to bubble up great models, you need measurements to start with. So we have that difficulty. And as Dan Geer likes to say, there are modelers and muddlers, people who create these formal models and then try and figure out where they can, you know, answer questions with numbers. And there are people who muddle through the existing data and find stuff out. And, the fact of the matter is we really need both, right? Modelers take this, you know, deductive approach, and you can see this in some of the work that I've been a part of, the factor analysis of information risk that Jack Jones did, that I got to work with him on a little bit, the stuff that Dave Mortman and I presented at Black Hat and other places a while ago, around motivation and threat modeling. And there's an inductive approach, right? And I've been, fortunate enough to be part of that, where you take a look at the data, right? And Verizon's Veris is a framework that we use to kind of take the data that we had, the narrative, and structure it. And reality is we need both of these approaches. So let's talk for a second about how we might pull in baseball here. I don't know if you guys have seen the movie or if you've read the book, but Moneyball was a great book that talked about a revolution, a data-based revolution in baseball, where you kind of threw out shamanism and, opinion by the loudest voice or tradition, and started using data effectively to make decisions and to be competitive. And as we see it, we can watch this happen over time. So this is a baseball card from the 50s, 1952 to be more exact. And it's around a Kevin Connors, a first baseman for the Los Angeles Angels, who are a minor league club, right? And basically you got one stat there, one quantitative stat, which was his batting average, right? And you got some other wonderful qualitative stats mixed in, like he's colorful, hard-hitting first baseman, right? Colorful. I don't know what that was a euphemism for in the 50s, but it was kind of interesting to see that. Now, after, kind of in the post-Moneyball world, we can take a look at a player from the 50s. This is Gil Hodges, and these are the lists from baseballreference.com that talked all about what Gil Hodges meant, right? Postseason, all-star, gobs of numerical measures and metrics, not just one bubbled-up metric like a batting average or so forth, but allows us to break down the complexity that is Gil Hodges and start talking about it. If you're on Baseball Reference, it even has comparisons, right? So I can see Gil Hodges, and they have, based on his stats and his career path, he's very similar to Paul Konerko or somebody like that. And I'm like, well, I've seen him play. I kind of know that, what kind of player he was now. That's very interesting. But the point is that complexity can be handled. And even after Moneyball, people said things like, well, we're not sure about fielding, right? Fielding is something that we can't really go out and take a tape measure and measure stuff. Well, actually, it turns out you can do a decent job and you can be accurate enough without worrying about precise to the inch on what Derek Jeter's range is. Here before you, you see two metrics for ultimate zone rating for two teams, the Minnesota Twins and the New York Yankees, right? And it's very interesting to me because we've taken the complex, you know, concept of fielding, being able to catch and throw and move around the field that isn't as measurable as a ball and a strike because you have this binary, did I hit it or did I not, outcome usually. And we're able to actually make decisions. Take a look at this. The larger and more blue the circle is, the better the fielding is. So if you were going to say who's a better defensive team, it's pretty obvious there's more blue over on the Minnesota Twins side. On the other hand, if you had to play against the Twins, you would know that you would load up your lineup with left-handed hitters who could pull the ball because they've basically got nothing at second. They've got nothing, on that side of the outfield. So it's very fascinating to me. The bottom line, where there is value, there is significant investment, and that will mean judgment, and we'll need that. And they are going to be inevitable. But right now what we get are kind of zombie metrics, back to the current state. These are actually copy and pasted out of some GRC suite where you've got a compliance score of 51.9%. Well, that may mean something, but a risk score of 17 means nothing, right? 17 what? 17 hows? How much is 17 better than a risk score of 32? Right, we don't know, and we'll never know because it's just not, you're not capable of having that level of measurement that our vendors are implying we do. We also get zombie wisdom. ALE is a great metric in context, but most of us abuse this. And what do I mean by that? A 1 in 100 year event that loses $1 billion is not the same as a 1 in 2 year event that loses $20 million in the mind of a decision maker. Okay, and they should be treated the same. Right, but yet we're all taught, when you take your CISSP course, right, one of the things you first learn is ALE, right? So what we have to do is figure out that, remember the reference to Thomas Kuhn and the proto-sciences, is figure that one out. And what we did was we took a look at sources of data, and really this is an oversimplification, but it's a great place to start. Risk is the intersection of several sets of information. Right. Think of it that way. Don't worry about RCSA. Don't worry about Octave and 800-30. Think about risk as being the intersection between your asset information, your impact information, your controls information, and the threat information that you have. And then you'll be able to start doing formal analysis. So let's talk about light and darkness for a sec. Josh?
So we're looking for sources of light. So if we're in this faith-based era and we want to be able to find out how can we do a better job, maybe it's not complete, maybe there's selection bias, maybe we're looking where light is best, but perhaps that's better than nothing. And, you know, just in a non-scientific way, we talked to as many systems as we could. Some people gave us their top 3 to 5. Some really generous folks gave us massive spreadsheets with every single metric they have in their organization. These are some of the top ones. Meantime, from patch I'm losing my slides here. So meantime from patch release to patch deploy. Our friend Jack Daniel has the business card that says the only viable measurement for security is failure. So when you look at these types of things we're measuring, they're the things that are easy. Someone's clicking on slides. Please stop. Okay, here we go. Some of the more interesting ones were operational, like top offense by department to see if certain departments were less disciplined than others, number of incidents, number of criticals and highs. These are the really obvious, easy things to collect. They aren't necessarily the most important things. Here are some of the things we don't measure. We hinted at this before at the rate of decay of, you know, for $1 million of antivirus, how much protection do I get versus $1 million of a web app firewall? So what's the efficacy per dollar, and is it remaining pretty strong, or is it decaying rapidly? Are there big class breaks for these various controls that we spend our finite resources on? Nor do we look at the opportunity costs of, okay, yeah, I have to buy this because I was told to by my auditor, but while I am spending on that, what am I not spending on? Whether it's my eyeball time looking at log files that people claim they do but never do, or something more realistic that's going to fit the skills and the priorities of your environment and your asset portfolio. So what are some of the favorite ones that you think we should be measuring, Alex, from this list?
Yeah, and I was clicking through. That was my bad. I like the, things that we need to start thinking about include non-PII losses. There's also the attacker-Mendoza line. We'll get more into that in H.D. Moore's law as
right.
you see it there. But I think that's a critical importance. And efficacy for controls, right, that's kind of my goal, my holy grail, is being able to repeatedly measure control infrastructures. So what we could measure, moving to the next slide, survivability duration, right? That's a great measurement state. Attacker drop-off rates is fantastic. Obviously, frequency of incidents and operational change is fantastic. Would love to be able to talk about complexity in environments. But I'm at the point where if we can, I think most CISOs, if they could just get their heads around visibility metrics, that would lead to all sorts of wonderful what we could measures.
Yeah, I think we mentioned this later, but if you haven't read Visible Apps, it's a very short read by Gene Kim and some others on just basically doing a real scientific, survey-based work, saying what are the common, for the people who have excellent kung fu and have fewer incidents, why was that? And after collecting lots and lots of operational metrics, they basically found that three of them had more impact on your outcomes than anything else, and that process turns out to be very useful for security as well. Many of us say the platitude of, compliance should be the natural byproduct of well-managed risk. And the interesting thing working with Gene Moore over the last year is that it seems like good risk management seems to be a natural byproduct of well-managed IT. So looking at the relationships on operational metrics, in addition to the kind of things that are easy to measure for pure security, you get a lot of good new things you could add to your tool bench. And, the Pareto principle is not magic. We love to say, well, it's an 80-20 rule, but sometimes it's a 20-80 rule, because of those rates of change and because of efficacy changes and decay. We really should scrutinize, are we spending 80% of our budget on a 20% solution, and how would you know? So one of my favorite lampposts Alex worked on, so I'll let Alex take it from here. But
in my past life, I was excited to work on the Data Breach Investigations Report with Verizon. And what we were able to do is work with our fantastic incident response team, as well as the U.S. Secret Service and the Dutch National High-Tech Crime Unit. I think this year Wade and his team are, those guys are working with a whole bunch of other folks. I'm not really privy to say whom at this point, but it's going to be I think this is going to be a great DBIR. But what we were able to do is basically develop Veris. And you can use Veris. It's free as in beer. For those of you familiar with open source parlance, try to get it as close to a Creative Commons license as possible. But basically, we were able to break down into a model where any incident can be described as having agents, right? And we have metadata around what agent is an external. Are they external to the company? Are they a partner of our company? Are they internal to the company? The agents had lists of actions. Those actions, the agent acted against an asset, so we had types and functions for the assets, and then attributes that, what those actions against the asset caused the security attribute to fail, right? And it's very cool, and you can go check that out. And in fact, on the next slide, you'll see that we were able to talk about an incident as a chain of these little event objects where each sort of a piece we were able to then describe patterns. And if you're familiar with chaos theory and complexity, what you really want to look for are patterns, right? And so what Wade did and the Verizon team did, and I was fortunate to be a little tiny part of it, is be able to take this sort of thing that you see, right, an incident report, and then create the patterns out of that using Veris. And that was very important. What it allowed us to do was actually come out with these statistics. Even though the sample, right, we're not saying we had to have a wonderfully structured sample, is they can be extremely meaningful in sort of an epidemiological approach to looking at what causes an incident.
Alex, right? Pause here for a second, if we could.
Yeah.
I saw identity and access management vendors as an analyst touting, look how many of these breaches, 48% of these breaches involved an insider or internal person. What they never showed, that second little graphic sideways, which showed as a percentage of records, actually says this isn't the right one, but you know, as a percentage of records, it was a much, much, much smaller thing. So this was the drunks and lampposts and compression abuse.
Yeah, absolutely. We've got a lot of that here in these sorts of things. When you start looking through it, and the ability to cherry pick one or two things, and you know, it's important again from an intellectually honest standpoint to remember that risk is kind of both frequency and magnitude, and we always try to present that, you know. But again, nature of statistics so that somebody can pick something out. And we do have really, really great information, right? SQL injection. This next one was fantastic. This is custom malware, right? And this is the use of custom malware in incidents over time. And that change, that 25% change between 2007 and 2008 is fascinating. Now, it is a change in the pattern. It is a change in the threat landscape. It is something that we were able to observe. And if you were a spry organization, right, you kind of already knew this was coming, or you may were part of those folks who were experiencing it before in the past. But now there's no ignoring that, you know, more than half the time, the signature-based antivirus, you know, that we rely on just isn't going to help us at all, right? Just isn't going to help us. So, and here's another, you know, we're able to talk about infection vectors and so forth. But, you know, I think the important thing is to say, is to explain here that we were able to track and we were able to trend and we were able to find out that, you know, there are myths around the intelligence of our adversary. They may be intelligent, but for the most part, we're not really forcing them to be. And that, again, leads back to a stress on operations. And the visible ops stuff that you keep hearing us talk about. So I think we can continue on there, Josh.
Sure. You know, as an analyst, I captured all the market spending, and since the numbers changed, I just kept this qualitative. The height of the bar is how much money we spend. So if you combine products and services, people security, that top bar was about $4 billion a year. Data security in its totality was $5 billion. That thin one I had to put the label on the side is less than a half a billion. I think Wendy Nather just did an excellent actual grounds-up market analysis of AppSec spending, and it was $444 million, which is the least invested, even though 89% of the records that year were SQL injection-type application attacks. About $10 billion on host, which is a server and endpoint, and $20 on network. An interesting thing, when you juxtapose evolving technology with this disparate spending, is that when you go into public cloud infrastructure, for example, you actually can't affect the network layer in most cases. So it's going to shift our sphere and span of control up the stack, hopefully to more appropriate balance on who's accessing which data via which applications, since that seems, based on the attack density data that Alex and Wade and others had focused us on, seems to be where a lot of these attacks are happening. I just find it... you know, data helps, and you look at how we spend the least money on AppSec, which was one of the most attacked layers, and yet we spend the most money on signature antivirus, which was the least successful in the data at least collected in their corpus. So this data should inform adjustments. If we're going to have a metrics initiative, we should probably be willing to confront the suggestions or implications of said data. You know, and that leads to situational awareness. If, in fact, you're facing, you know, advanced persistent threats or whatever the kit-and-killing term people want to use is, you're going to have to act more like an early adopter than if you're defending against just antivirus or antivirus from the PCI Rocks video. If all you have to face is a QSA as an adversary, then, yeah, just solve for that. But if you actually have different adversaries in that pantheon of adversaries, then you need to pay different attention. This was some secondary analysis I did on the next slide, but this came out of this year's DBIR, and I saw this as the mission accomplished flag for the PCI Council, saying, look, we had 360 million, I mean, they could fly it on some banner, some aircraft carrier, but maybe a little premature, because what it points out is the number of records went from 360 million in 2008 down to, you know, 100-fold drop in 2 years to 3.8 million. If you actually peel into that, it's really not a success. If you look at the types of breaches from that year to year, you know, intellectual property loss went from 10 to 41, up 31. National security data, I'm kind of concerned about that, 1 to 20. Sensitive organizational up on higher value non-credit card asset types.
It's also, Josh, let me interrupt and say, it's also important to note the aggregate economic impact, right? So the big difference between, let me go back to the back one slide, the big difference between 08 and 010 numbers also has to deal with the demographics of those who are suffering it. A lot of those 08 numbers were specific attackers who the U.S. Secret Service and Verizon and other folks helped bring down. But they were attacking organizations that could better absorb that sort of impact. 2010, we saw that change from larger retailers with large monies to smaller amounts and smaller retailers who cannot afford the economic impact of having an investigation, right? This is your mom-and-pop shop, not, you know, next to the grocery store, not the grocery store themselves. So, again, you can't talk about mission accomplished in terms of security in aggregate and stealing, in, like Josh says, we've got national security data, intellectual property, organizational, you know, stuff that's sensitive you don't want out. And then you also have, well, there's a broader economic impact that's happening here where people are losing not just their jobs because there's a breach, but they're losing their livelihood.
Yeah, and in fact, someone pushed back at one of our live presentations correctly and said, well, didn't, you know, I know the number of records dropped for credit cards by 100-fold, but didn't the street price also drop about 100-fold, which is an interesting parallel number to measure. And then another pushback was, given the selection bias of who the Secret Service tends to investigate breaches for and who Verizon's clientele was, you know, if it's intellectual property, it tends not to go to the Secret Service, but rather to the FBI. So I was actually surprised to see so many intellectual property thefts in this corpus. But, you know, let's talk about some attacker diversity quickly so we can get to some of these questions. I see one of the questions entered does talk about attacker classes. We've got to stop thinking about the bad guy as this monolithic thing. And oftentimes in debates over PCI, someone would say to me, Josh, you know, I know that I can't stop a determined attacker, but can't PCI stop at least a casual attacker? Can't they make it so they move on? So I tried to say, how tall is a casual attacker, and therefore how tall do you have to be to ride? This is related to what Alex and I have talked about before with the Mendoza line, but since not enough people know who the Mendoza is from baseball, we took Moore's Law, right? So most people know Moore's Law, that compute power doubles every 12 to 24 months, and spun at Metricon 6, HD Moore's Law. So casual attacker strength grows at the rate of Metasploit, and we'll visualize that real fast. Essentially, the vertical axis is how successful is the attacker, so they're 100% successful across how much security you've done. And I call it securons to deliberately make fun that this isn't about a dollar amount or an effort amount. It's actual growth or yield and how well you defend. And you map some adversary classes. And what I'm essentially suggesting here is an attacker, this green line, the casual attacker, will be 100% successful until you've exhausted their attack capacity. And as a proxy that you can actually measure instead of just guesswork, I'm asserting that that is H.D. Moore's law, which is today's free version of Metasploit. Not Metasploit Pro, not all the add-ons, just the lower bounds of a casual attacker. If you can handle anything they can throw at you as a script kiddie, then you can cause a precipitous drop-off in the success rate of that adversary class. And you know, one question is, for compliance, is if you add in the adversary class known as the QSA, you can make them go away way easier than you can make even a casual adversary go away. There may have been a time when these lines touched or when the purple line was taller than the green line, but essentially because Metasploit is constantly updated by smart folks, even people listening to this webinar, it's constantly moving to the right, whereas the compliance standards seldom change and are really predicated on a 2003-era model of threat. If you add in people asking me, what about anonymous? So I'm saying casual adversaries aren't much more talented at the moment than a casual attacker. They're just a little stickier with their targets. So, you know, maybe a credit card thief might look at target.com and fail and move on to Walmart just as easily. Whereas maybe someone who wants to punish Target is going to stay on them a little longer and try a little harder. Really, most of the breaches, at least through my information gathering capacities, aren't really script kiddies anyhow. They're either individuals or small groups of organized crime or large groups of organized crime, and they have their own toolkits. They don't necessarily bother with open source projects that a script kiddie would. And then if you've been unfortunate to join the club of the state-sponsored espionage, really, even if you can start to cause them to exhaust their attack capacity, they're financially and and nationally motivated to continue to reinvest. So it becomes a tit-for-tat, kind of a chess game against an adaptive adversary. And, you know, theoretically, you can cause them to give up or mess up, but essentially that's a much taller bill. And because people think it's silly to call it H.G. Moore's law because he's so far off the charts as an attacker, we put him off the chart. But does it matter is the question. So back to Alex's so what in huge font. It kind of does. We asked Wade to filter out from last year's corpus of data. I said, you know, filter out anything that isn't intellectual property or classified. And would the attack patterns be the same? And you'll notice the number one here was actually, when I cross-referenced it, was number 18 in the overall. So the kind of techniques used by those stealing credit cards seem to differ quite a bit from the attack patterns used by those stealing intellectual property. And there's more that we can maybe get into during Q&A on that. If you compare and contrast these pantheon of adversaries, you know, they're after different assets. They operate on a different time frame. They have different strengths, like we showed on the H.G. Moore's chart, which I've blogged about elsewhere. But target stickiness is low or high, probability, impact, et cetera. These things do matter, and it starts to raise the question, if we don't have all the right data right now, do we wait for it, or do we do a fight for your life and basically pay attention to which adversaries are after which of our assets using which preferred attack methods that we have in sources like the DBIR, TrustWave, or Mandiant reports. And that might be a more tenable way to fight off the zombie horde. Alex?
So we always get asked, where do we like to see information from? There are great sources of data, all the way to really bad sources of data. but there's lots. I'm a big believer in data loss database. If you guys have need tax write-offs for this year, I'd strongly recommend donating to the Open Security Foundation. Microsoft SIR continues to be a great piece of information. Obviously, we talked about Verizon and TrustWave and so forth. You get great labs testing results within context. Those are really useful. Sometimes the context is a little abstract once you boil it down. You also get some luminaries, right? You know, you've got true lights versus false prophets. Folks who are interested in furthering, you know, the various economic pursuits of their own. But I also enjoy very much communities like, you know, the securitymetrics.org mailing list. You know, obviously, I've already, you know, suggested that everybody look into the Society of Information Risk Analysts because I think that's a great area for trying to glean wisdom out of data as well. But there are great blogs out there to read and so forth.
And we're going to want Gene to cherry pick the most difficult questions for us really quickly, so we can take one or two towards the end. But, you know, my parting advice is, while smart folks like Alex and others and like Wade and others are trying to find an approach that actual area of certainty, in the meantime, don't be passive. It's still a fight for your life. So, you know, look at this more like game theory or complex system theory than, you know, actuarial certainty, and deploying an OODA loop in the meantime, if not forever, are going to have a much, much better chance of survival.
Yeah, and if you want certainty, focus on basics, because that's exactly what, if you look at the data breach investigations report and you look at visible ops, the large part of the curve is because somebody fell down on something particularly basic.
Yeah, default passwords and things are still legion. So here's some of the apply stuff. I think we are going to make these slides available, so we will not read them to you. And if you want follow-on conversations, here are our respective emails and Twitter accounts to follow on the Twitters, if you'd like to engage our brains. Gene, do we have time for a question, or if we go fast?
Yeah, we have time for a couple questions, and if people want to stay on for a few minutes, we can probably address some more. So one of the questions is, do you feel it's really getting worse, or is the FUD cycle just more in our face? Are the adversaries really more in number or in greater skill, or we just hear about them more due to disclosure laws and such?
So I'll run with that one for a sec, Josh. The answer is depends.
Yeah.
Depends on, you know, your organization and what you're facing. I don't think, if I were a mid-sized retailer or a large retailer, I don't think that I would be applying the flood cycle that much. I would be that worried about things getting worse from the specific attack classes. Now, I don't work for one, so I can't say with any authority, right? I'm going off of last year's data. If, however, I was worried about intellectual property, if I was somebody that, would work for somebody that was easily a target of hacktivists, groups, I sure think that we've had significant changes in the threat landscape over the past 12, 14 months.
Yeah, I mean, if you just look at one lens alone, which is mainstream media coverage, there's been more than a breach a week in 2011. It's been insane. So if anything, not necessarily the number of breaches, but the insight and publicity of them has certainly gone up just surely from site clicks and hits on mainstream news versus trade rag. But also, Alex and I maintain lots of relationships with Fortune 100, Fortune 500 companies, and I pretty much know about most of the intellectual property losses or espionage attacks, and the number and size of them have gone way up. And this is one of the reasons I get so angry that we don't have mandatory disclosure laws or better sources to at least collect and anonymize these less publicized attacks, because you would be able to see, yes, those went up a lot more than we realized, because we would have been capturing them. So I'd love to see the scientific rigor and transparency of something like the DBIR applied to other data types. And at the moment, the incentives aren't there to populate those. So my personal experience in InfoSec is it's gotten really crazy on multiple fronts.
Okay, thanks. Just for those of you that need to sign off, we will have the recording of this webcast on our website in the next couple of days, including the questions. So we'll continue to ask Alex and Josh a couple more questions. And the next question is, what is the difference between adaptive and inductive?
I'm going to assume that means deductive and inductive. Inductive is something observed. Deductive is, you can think of as something reasoned, and there you really need a mashup of both in order to get a quality state of wisdom. Adaptive just means that that whatever object you're talking about changes against the stimulus. I'm thinking that was a deductive inductive.
Okay. Some people are asking about the slides. I'll just say that if you right-click on the presentation, you'll see download to PDF, or go to the top where you see the little pieces of paper icon, and the slides are there as well to download. The next question is kind of a long one. I can understand the ability to provide metrics about systems, but business's repeated process that involves systems and people. Unless you mitigate the human risk, you don't really have the true corporate risk mitigation, but system risk mitigation. One, what kind of metrics can you offer to estimate human or zombie employees-related risks? In the last 20 years, we have very limited academic research on the subject of information security awareness. Do you think we even have a methodology that we can estimate human risk in information security? And three, a behavior analysis which will constantly measure employees is considered illegal in almost any organization country. As this is the case, how can we have any metrics at all?
I wouldn't even know where to start on that one, Alex.
Let's tackle this, and we may not have answers, right? Well, it disappeared. Hold on. Shoot, I was going off of the question. Okay, there it is. All right, sorry, wrong tab. All right, so unless you mitigate the human threat rather than human risk, because risk means something specific to me, and I'll be pedantic, that's fine. You don't really have a true corporate risk mitigation, but a systems mitigation. So there are a couple of things that I would encourage you to do. There's lots of aspects to threat modeling. There's motivation modeling, understanding what data you have, right, and so forth. So you can do sort of a deductive reasoned aspect. You can even look to take frequencies, both frequencies from outside your organization and think if they meaningfully apply, and try and get that sort of information around those. A great and easy example is lost laptops, right? My organization knows exactly how many lost laptops we lose, you know, how many laptops we may or may not lose per year, right? So that's kind of easy for us to understand. In the last 20 years, we have a limited academic security awareness. We have a methodology that we can use to estimate human risk and information security. Depends on how you create a model that explains this concept of human risk that you want to talk about here, right? And from our standpoint, right, and I can only talk to you about what I've been able to do as a consultant as somebody who's working for an organization, as I've done it and talking about it, I want to understand frequency with which I can expect a specific motivated threat community to act, right? And then basically the types of actions that they will most probably take and whether or not I can resist those actions with any degree of certainty. Now, answering one and two here, let me qualify by saying we have a huge amount of uncertainty in our data. It's not high-quality data by any stretch of the imagination. But when you're faced with that, you use actuarial methods, and that's another sub-point, right? If you ever hear somebody say, actuarial quality data, know that they don't know what they're talking about because there is no actuarial quality data. There are only actuarial methods applied to data sets, right? And so you have to think very carefully and perform very carefully in that regards and understand kind of what you're doing. The third one, a behavioral analysis, which will constantly measure employees considered illegal. How can we use any metrics at all? Yeah, I don't think that the idea here in doing threat motivation modeling and getting frequencies is to take a frequentist approach where we are counting mouse clicks or anything like that. I think Jack Jones is famous for talking about a level of abstraction, thinking about Google Maps as an analogy. We're not trying to get at the street view here, right, and take the street view of Google Maps from destination to destination. We might be at a county view. We might be at a state view. We might only have enough data and methods at our disposal to be at a national view even at times, right, or a regional view. I don't think it's necessary in order to get a quality state of wisdom to be at that street level view, as you're insinuating with that last question. But these are very great thoughts. I want to preface that. I'll also put out that folks always want to get the entire DBIR data set. I don't work for Verizon anymore, but there's an email in the DBIR, and you can email those guys and ask them all about it.
I can give some maybe sideways answers to the same questions, which is, although many people sometimes think a pen test is how cheaply can I pay for an Nessus scan to pass my PCI ROC, there are actual excellent pen testers and pen testing organizations who include testing the social engineering resolve and resistance and awareness of your employees. They do stats for you, like, we put infected USB key fobs in the parking lot smoking areas, and here's how many people fell for it. There's things out of Carnegie Mellon, I think it's called fishme.com, that, you can test how resilient your guys are against excellent phishing methods and state-of-the-art phishing approaches that are actually pretty commonly used in a lot of these industrial espionage attacks. But there are the feedback loops that you can get. In fact, one of my favorite CISOs paid $2 million of marketing dollars to do internal security training that didn't suck, I think is how he put it. So $2 million is a lot of money, but not really, because what he did is he took 60,000 walking, talking liabilities and turned them into 60,000 walking, talking security sensors. And they measured inputs and outputs for desired outcomes, and they had human metrics on not just who took a PowerPoint that they're going to ignore that was written 15 years ago, but rather, how did they retain the information, how did they put it to practice, and they even put some reward and incentive programs in such that people who found a key fob and turned it into security got, spiffs or Best Buy cards or things like that. So these are quick and dirty answers that are trying to shotgun at an answer we can't hear a live interaction with. But there are ways to measure the social engineering resolve or resistance or situational awareness of your employees. And lastly, things like visible ops and whatnot have kind of focused me on the idea that not everybody needs access to everything. So we sometimes tolerate elective attack surface and elective human involvement when we could have fewer people having copies of data and maybe just having views or presentation of data, thus making it harder for any one person getting human popped to turn into an actual incident. So we can always have private or Skypes or Twitter exchanges if people want to take that to the next level of granularity. But hopefully that was enough of an answer for a complex question.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. And thank you, Josh and Alex. Thank you for participating in our RSA Conference webcast series featuring highly rated presentations from RSA Conference. Our next webcast is scheduled for January 25th on using online advertising to find out if your data is valuable to a criminal. We'll have more information on the website shortly. You can download the slides. We also will have the recording on our website. So you may now disconnect. Thank you.